Thank you very much, Andrey Pavlovich. Okay. Can you hear me well? Okay. As we discussed, it's a great pleasure to present this lecture at this auditorium because I represent two labs. One is laboratory in Ufa. This is with title Institute of Physics of Advanced Materials at Ufa State Aviation Technical University. And second laboratory, it's mega laboratory in St. Petersburg State University, laboratory of bulk mechanics of bulk nanomaterials. Okay, no, and I know, of course, many colleagues here, and it's great pleasure, really great pleasure to present this lecture here. And the title of lecture dealing is with bulk nanostructural materials. No, mostly focus will be on metallic materials, but many principles are possible to apply for different kind of materials. And central focus will be on superior or unique properties of these materials and potential for application, for innovative application. Now, after short introduction, I would like to consider some principle of nanostructuring, as I mentioned, metallic materials by processing route will be called severe plastic deformation. And but central part will be this principle of nanostructural design, how we can use this principle of nanostructuring to enhance properties of materials. And this is properties we call multifunctional properties because, for example, strength and ductility, strength and conductivity. This is nice example of multifunctional properties because when typically we can increase strength, we will be decrease conductive properties, for example. And how we can design materials with improved both these characteristics. And the same for enhancement of mechanical properties and corrosion or radiation resistance, for example. And how is important such type of approach for potential application. But at the beginning, briefly, what means bulk nanostructural materials? Because according to modern classification of nanomaterials, we consider four main types. One of them is this is atomic clusters. Unfortunately, cannot illustrate. One of them atomic clusters or nanoparticles. Nano it means the size of these particles typically less than 100 nanometers. And this is famous international definition of nanomaterials. The second type of nanomaterials, multi-layers or nanolayers, this is materials containing many layers with thickness typically less than 100 nanometers. One more type of nanomaterials, this we call nanostructural coatings. And the coatings may be larger in size, several micrometers, for example. However, microstructure or nanostructure inside has a typical size of nanostructural elements less than 100 nanometers. But focus of this presentation will be bulk nanostructural materials. Bulk nanostructural materials, they may have sizes centimeters or meters, and very often we expect many meters. Well, I will be demonstrate some technique which can produce such large or bulk, massive piece of nanomaterials. However, the microstructure has, this is typical ultra-fine grain structure with size of grain size or crystal size less than one micrometer and typically less than 100 nanometers. If we have larger grain size, we have another nanostructural features like nanotwins, nanoparticles, and so on. I will be demonstrate in detail this definition of bulk nanostructural materials. Okay. Topic of nanomaterials very popular, and maybe you know there is a great main international conference on nanomaterials, considering different kind of nanomaterials. But last was in Moscow State University less than 2 years ago, and it was organized 11 sections, and I would like mention bulk nanomaterials were one of the main section, most one of the most popular section at this main conference, or better to say congress. Okay, but how we can process this such type of nanomaterials? There are two approach in literature, we call bottom-up approach and top-down approach. Bottom-up approach based on consolidation of individual clusters of particles in bulk shape through, for example, technique of inert gas condensation or preparation of nanoclusters or nanoparticles and their compaction. Now, this is very well-known technique, it's really topic of bulk nanomaterials started from work of Professor Gleiter in Germany from such processing route or synthesis route. But from other hand, this is such approach has many limitations. For example, even now size of samples or billets produced by this way is only 10 maximum 10 millimeters, so it's relatively small. It's typically in shape of disk. Another way how we can produce bulk nanostructural material, electrodeposition. But this is really we can produce coating and with nanocrystalline grains. However, these coatings presently may have quite large thickness, about tens of micrometers. And third way, consolidation of nanopowders process, for example, by ball milling and then compaction bulk shape is also well known. And however, even now is still under development because typically bulk nanomaterials produced by this way has many porosity, some contamination, so they have some artifacts. And this is very important to analyze properties. That's why another approach called top-down attracted more and more attention, now is most popular. It's based on shock wave loading and technique called severe plastic deformation. And this technique started in the beginning of 90s, and I would like to show the first example how was produced ultra-fine grain materials from conventional materials. This is example of kappa. From left side is conventional coarse grain kappa, and here billet produced by severe plastic deformation. Any section of this billet with quite large size, 20 millimeters in diameter and length more than 100 nanometers, has such uniform ultra-fine grain structure. Only through processing by plastic deformation we could produce such uniform kind of nanostructure. It was this topic was started in beginning of 90s, and that time we used two techniques, and now they are popular and possible to find in many labs, and in particular in our laboratory in St. Petersburg State University, we create laboratory of severe plastic deformation with different kind of technique of SPD techniques. One of these techniques we call now high pressure torsion, and second is equal chain and angular pressing. principle, this technique you can find, as I mentioned, in textbook, but they based on combination of high pressure and high plastic deformation. For example, sample in this shape, like here, is subjected to compression and then torsion deformation. And pressure is really large here in several GPA. Another technique is looks different, but principle very similar. In this case, also there is application of high pressure in zone of chair straining, and also the size of billets or sample is the same after processing. Therefore, we can process the process materials several times and introduce really huge deformation. No, there are presently many modifications of this Yole techniques and appearance of new techniques in literature. Possible to find more than 10 different SPD techniques which now applied for processing ultra-fine grain material. However, still these two techniques is most popular, and for example, 90% of all publication, about maybe several hundred each year, is based on development and using these two techniques. However, to produce ultra-fine grain structure, also important to find optimal processing regimes and routes. We consider five main parameters we call basic rules for grain refinement. Among these parameters, of course, temperature of deformation. It must be really low, than less than 0.4 from melting temperature. Only in this case we can introduce huge dislocation density, and then as a result of evaluation of dislocation structure to form ultra-fine grains. And deformation must be really large. More than true strain of is more than 6 or 8, and this is much higher than we can use for using conventional processing routes based on heavy plastic deformation. Only with such large deformation we can introduce ultra-fine grains having high-end grain, not cell structure, not substructure, but high-end grain boundaries. And also to reach such large deformation at low temperature, we must use high pressure, because in this case we can enhance deformability of materials and suppress defect annihilation. This is also helpful to produce ultra-fine grain structure. Okay, and from point of view mechanics, important to have elements of vorticity and non-monotonic metal flow. And this is helping to produce acquiesce, as I showed, ultra-fine grain structure, not elongated grains. So this is principle, as I mentioned, dealing with processing routes and regimes. From other hand, there is parameters associated with materials atomic structure. For example, ordering or stocking fall energy. And this is important to produce smallest grain size. Now this principle was established, but first principle will be published in this journal, famous journal in material science, Progress Material Science, in a paper with style bulk nanostructure materials from severe plastic deformation. And really this topic started to be popular, and you see the very high citation, only one this publication demonstrated how broad and how popular this area presently. Okay, now I would like to move to topic of my presentation, and briefly only mention about some modification of SPD technique which we use presently. No, one of them we call ECAPO with parallel channels, equal channel angular pressing with parallel channel, which is much more efficient, effective to compare to conventional ECAP. And another technique called ECAP conform, I will be show in facilities for such new technique. And can produce, this is continuous processing and can produce many, many meters of sample or rods. And in our laboratory be quite easy, can process now 20, and by this year we have task to produce 250 meters of rod from some special aluminum alloys. Okay, but regarding properties, we need to consider more precisely what means nanostructures in these materials processed by severe plastic deformation. If we consider conventional conventional transmission electron microscopy and will be used to observe microstructure, we will see ultrafine grains and quite complex structure, because definitely there is some another kind of defect and a lot of grain bundles, but we cannot say exactly what means structure of these grain bundles. Therefore, we need to use more special kind of microstructural observation. And in our studies, many of them were done in collaboration with our colleagues, partners. We use three different kind of precise microstructural observation and special facilities. One of these scanning electron microscope enabled to analyze, for example, mesoretache parameters of grains using EBSD analysis. Another, this is technique transmission electron microscopy, but with special focus for high resolution electron microscopy enabling to observe individual atoms. And this is third is atom tomography. This is kind of ion microscopy with observation of atomically observation chemical composition of materials. And such type of studies started quite recently. For example, one of this first publication with Alex Zelyaev and colleagues demonstrated possibility to use EBSD analysis in the scanning electron microscope, and you can see nice picture with ultrafine grains. This is pure nickel is like example, but very important, using such approach we can analyze a fraction of low-end grain boundaries and high-end grain boundaries. I will be sure this is critically important to produce new properties. And after some special processing regime, we can produce really huge density of high-end grain boundaries with amount of more than 60 or in some cases in 80%. Using high-resolution microscopy, we enable to observe atomic structure of interfaces. And вот, for example, this example of aluminium 3% magnesium with grain size of 100 nanometers. This is one of the our earliest observation of grain boundaries by high-resolution electron microscopy. This is a pictures of these two regions with atomic resolution. This is atomic planes. And you can see grain boundary is not perfect. There is some features like steps, facets at grain boundaries. And I will be show how it may be important to produce new properties. Not only grain size, grain boundary structure. And another example, again, ultrafine grain structure, and we see the atomic resolution of grain boundary, and again we see not perfect grain boundary with some special feature, and we call non-equilibrium such type of grain boundaries we call non-equilibrium strain distorted grain boundaries. This observation will be presently we have several time of this, such observation. And fit with the concept of non-equilibrium grain boundaries introduced in 90s and beginning of this century. This concept based on the representative of grain boundary in bicrystal like this, or in from single crystal by different obeya. In this case, we have for the same mesorientation parameter, we have no long-range stresses and minimal grain boundary energy. This is case of equilibrium grain boundary. This is case of non-equilibrium grain boundary. So when for the same mesorientation parameters, we have higher energy and also long-range stresses and enhanced free volume. In practice, we can produce such type of grain boundaries through interaction of boundaries with lattice dislocation, and then some dissociation of this lattice dislocation into grain boundary. Вот, for example, in our recent publication with Professor Avitka and Kovbekov, so we analyze this situation of different kind of grain boundaries. Okay, and from such approach we can estimate main parameter of such non-equilibrium grain boundary, like excess energy of this grain boundary dislocation, excess energy of junction disclination and gliding dislocation. I would like only to say now we have apparat, mathematical apparat, how we can analyze quantitatively parameters of such non-equilibrium grain boundary. And therefore we can consider ultrafine grain materials and nanomaterials as containing two phases, one of grain boundary phase and second lattice phase, and this is also important representation of ultrafine grain structure to understand their unique properties. No, also by severe plastic deformation, another kind of defects will be called twin, nano-twins, can be introduced in ultrafine grain structure, and also this important parameter. But now I would like to briefly to move to chemistry of grain boundaries. And such type of analysis possible to investigate through atom probe tomography. And you know, this is kind of ion microscopy, and image at screen we can be formed through analysis of ions from samples. And you can see here example of distribution of copper atoms for example, in steel. This now technique is experimental technique is well established. Unfortunately, in Russia we have only one or two such facilities. But many labs now they try to introduce these techniques to analyze chemistry of dislocation, different defects, and to be used with our colleagues from France to investigate grain boundaries in ultrafine grain materials. And you can see that there was first observation of special segregation of magnesium, copper, silicon and grain boundaries, and to be found is really unusual segregation may have after in some aluminium alloys after forming ultrafine grain structure. A bit later it was such approach was used for many materials, and this is another example of also aluminium alloys, but with different chemical composition. You can see this grain, small grains and distribution of segregation at a long grain boundaries in Trabzon, and thickness only 1-2 nanometers. And you can see this how important such precise type of observation. Well, this is another example of absolutely different kind of segregation. And this is composition of this material, aluminium zinc, and we found very thin layer along grain boundaries of zinc phase, I will be showing several such example. And so segregation may have very unusual shape and very unusual configuration. However, because we can use different kind of processing routes in regime, we can control grain boundary structure, crystallographic parameters, chemistry, and defect structure. And therefore, we can consider a concept of grain boundary design or engineering of ultrafine grain materials, focusing through variation of grain boundary structure, having thickness only 1, 2, 3 nanometers. This is a new approach how we can control properties. So we called this about 10 years ago as this concept grain boundary design of SPD process nanomaterials. And now I would like to show how we can use this approach to get very unusual multifunctional properties in ultrafine grain materials. And my focus today will be on enhanced strength and ductility of bulk nanostructural materials, and strength and electric conductivity, few example, increased strength and corrosion radiation resistance, and some biomedical properties, you know, for example, nanostructural titanium. Okay, from the beginning of such research of bulk nanostructural materials, it was clear when we have smaller grain size, we may have very high strength, because we know there is very well-known hole patch relationship, and smaller grain size will have stronger materials. At elevated temperature, another phenomenon we call superplasticity may be enhanced, because in this case grain size. If smaller grain size, we have a higher strain rate for superplasticity or lower temperature. So we really, through control of grain size, we can control properties. And this is now well established relationship. As I mentioned, there is famous Hall patch law describing enhancement of strength with decreasing grain size. However, different studies of really ultrafine grain materials having grain size smaller than 100 nanometers showed some anomaly. It was called negative Hall patch relationship, like this. So with smaller grain size, strength may be decreased. No, there are several explanations why it might be so, and with publication in Science, in Nature, what is physical reason for this. But even some modeling is different. This is associated with very high density of interfaces with their new behavior. However, from practical point of view, very interesting and important to have not softening, some additional hardening, but curve two, leading to really super strong state, really ultimate hardening. And how we can move to this way, how we can additionally improve strength of materials. Но for this we need to consider strengthening mechanism in nanomaterials. And our main idea was to control not only grain size, to control grain boundary structure. So when we consider strengthening mechanism, we may see the whole strength, total strength, is associated with different parameters. This is grain size, as I mentioned. This is appearance of precipitation in some nano-precipitation in some alloys. This is associated with solid solution, with dislocation density, and might be some new mechanism of strengthening leading to such super strong state. However, this problem is really complicated because even we consider this dislocation hardening, we may see the contribution of dislocation may be very different for depending on where we have dislocation. Dislocation may be inside grain, at grain boundaries, form some substructure. And also solution clusters and grain boundary segregation may also contribute to hardening. Such problem was analyzed during last year in several materials. In our laboratory we paid attention on several aluminum alloys where depending from processing routes, for example, temperature, strain rate, we could introduce different grain size and we could introduce different kind of precipitation, like in this case. And this table illustrates for different processing regimes various structural parameters, grain size, size of precipitation, and so on. And we could analyze contribution of these different parameters in total strength. And this table illustrates experimental value of yield stress and calculation from different microstructural parameters. And you can see this is quite good fit in demonstrating this approach good. And this approach demonstrates for materials having not very high strength, about, no, for aluminum alloys, about 300-400 megapascal, contribution of grain size is main factor. However, dislocation density and some segregation phenomena, it might be also important to get higher strengths. Okay, this is quite conventional kind of materials. However, using nanostructure in bisevere plastic deformation, possible to get very unusual, unique results. Вот this is demonstrate, picture demonstrate development of aluminum alloys during 70 last years. At first, with through chemical composition, then through variation of microstructure. And here, you can see the new result obtained using nanostructure in bisevere plastic deformation, where in aluminum alloy we could get strengths about 1,000 megapascal. As you know, many steel, they have strengths visibly less. So aluminum became stronger than steel. And what mechanism of so super strong state? And in this case also we observed quite sufficient ductility. And to analyze origin, physical nature of such super strong state, we built a whole patch analysis, and we found even for smallest grain size, which we can produce in this material, strength cannot be higher than 500 MPa. However, experimentally we got for several aluminum alloys much higher strengths. What physical reason of this? And when we analyze structure of grain boundaries, as I mentioned, we found this unusual phenomenology, appearance of segregation and in some cases nanocluster situated in grain boundaries in triple junction. But here is this quantitative analysis using 3D atom probe of segregation phenomena in grain boundaries. You can see this is really unusual segregation. For example, thickness is broader than wider than thickness of atomic structure of grain boundaries, several nanometers. Also concentration of segregation here, magnesium in aluminum alloys, is much higher, about 30, up to 30% is much higher than average value in 5 or even more times. Therefore, in ultra-fine grain materials processed by severe plastic deformation, we may have very unusual chemistry of segregation at grain boundaries. They we could not observe such segregation in any materials after any process. Therefore, our idea about such unusual segregation may lead to new mechanical behavior of materials. Okay, so it was our basis, and we investigated by now many alloys, and for example, this steel, austenitic steel, and we also produced different kind of microstructures, and again we found depending from not only from grain size, from grain boundary structure, we may have different strengths and hardness. And like you can see here, this is whole patch relationship. This is for larger grain size, we may have very high strengths, about 2000 MPa. This is very unusual strength for such material. And again, when we analyze grain boundary structure, we found very unusual segregation of silicon, nickel, and some another alloy element. So all of this, when we have some unusual phenomena in strength behavior, we may observe unusual segregation in grain boundaries. Therefore, it was a basis for our phenological model, dislocation emission from grain boundaries having segregation, and from such type of analysis we found quite good fit in prediction of our model and experimental observation. So we can say origin of super strong state in bulk nanomaterial materials may be associated with not only with grain size, with structure of grain boundary containing unusual segregation of chemical elements. Okay, so this is strength, but for any structural application we need to consider strength and ductility in combination. And this is great problem for bulk nanomaterials. Now, for example, Professor Avitko wrote on this several publications, but I will be briefly explain how this is important for ultrafine grain materials produced by severe plastic deformation. But this is two pictures of strain, stress strain curves for aluminium. For aluminium and practically commercially pure iron, IF steel. And you see, for grain size, about 10 micrometers, we have normal behavior, softening at the low yield strength, and then hardening and quite large ductility. And this is very nice publication of Professor Tsuji from Japan, where they presented first observation of effect of grain size on strain behavior. But with smaller grain size, mechanical behavior essentially different. For example, in this case, we have much stronger state. However, ductility is less, and there is we cannot see hardening. So really, mechanism of deformation is changing. And from practical point of view, such behavior is not so attractive because for good material for structural application, we need to have not only very high strength, on also ductility, toughness. We must have much higher than we have in this case. Therefore, it was a task how we can improve ductility, keeping very high strength. This is really kind of paradox, because typically stronger materials is less ductile. This is basic rule for material science. And interesting, we could find a solution and presently there is several such type of solution how we can get high strength and ductility. I will be show one of them dealing again with grain boundary structure variation. And our principle of our analysis based on mechanics of tensile behavior. To get high ductility, we need to enhance strain hardening or enhance strain rate hardening. This is also rule from mechanics of plastic deformation. And but how in reality we can improve this characteristic, especially strain rate hardening? And therefore we need to control not only grain size, we need to control grain body structure. It was our idea in our early publication, which presently called Paradox of Strength and Ductility in SPD Nanomaterials, when we showed for the first time how we could find solution of such paradox to get very high strength and ductility, elongation to failure, in contrast to any metallic materials from this from periodical table. You know, we know, for example, for copper, materials may be stronger, but ductility will be less. Even for aluminium, the same picture after some plastic deformation. However, with application of severe plastic deformation, it was first observation, we could get very high strength and ductility. What is the physical reason for this? And I will be showing our recent result. Not only enhanced ductility, super ductility possible to get if we can control grain boundary structure. We investigated again aluminium zinc alloy, and this is mechanical curve strength ductility, and you see in some cases this material is demonstrated at room temperature not several percent of elongation, more than 100%. So it was why this material was so ductile. And at the same time, we analyzed strain rate sensitivity and also we found unusual value. Why materials may be demonstrate absolutely different behavior? And when we started analyzing mechanism of deformation, we found in this case we may have unusual grain boundary sliding. Unusual because it's room temperature, low temperature, typically grain boundary sliding may have may be observed only at elevated temperature. What you see this observation using atom force microscope near indent, and you see very essential difference in conventional this alloy and ultra-fine grain alloy. Here is clear indication of grain boundary sliding. And when we analyzed grain boundary structure, we found very thin layer of zinc in this. It's like wetting of grain boundary, so we can or smoothing of grain boundary, so we could process by during grain refinement by severe plastic deformation. And this is enabled to enhance diffusivity along grain boundaries, and therefore we could realize grain boundary sliding at room temperature, and therefore dramatically change mechanical behavior of this alloy. Okay, so we can control not only room temperature through grain boundary engineering, we can control in superplasticity or enhanced plasticity. And this is important parameter because superplasticity is very attractive for many applications and this area of really technological interest, but we need to have low temperature for this phenomena and high strain rate. And through grain boundary control, we may reach these requirements. And you see this example of low temperature and high strain rate superplasticity when elongation more than 1000% may be observed at real condition of strain rate and temperature. So, and this is really important to for forming complex shape paths, for example. Okay, so, but this strategy also important to enhance not only strength and conductivity, for example, fatigue behavior and toughness, and this is has a practical application. This is very nice result how we can improve fatigue strength in titanium materials more than 2 times through variation of grain size and grain boundary structure. Now I will be missing how this is practically important. I would like to demonstrate. I have 6 minutes. I will be demonstrate several examples how we use for practical for future practical application. One of this area titanium. Titanium in medicine for medical application, because titanium from bio properties, from strength, is very promising materials for producing different kind of medical implants, devices, and so on. However, the strength of pure titanium is much less than for titanium alloys, and there is question was there is chance to enhance strength of pure titanium, and we applied severe plastic deformation processing to refine structure in commercially pure titanium, and as a result we could enhance not only strength and also fatigue endurance, and therefore such materials became very attractive for to produce new kind of implants. And this is rods produced from nanostructural titanium having very high strength and ductility and fatigue insurance. And expert in biomechanics suggested, in this case, if we have so strong materials, we can produce new kind of implants. And instead conventional implants, then produced from nano-titanium such miniature implants, this dental implant was first example. And this is much more conventional for dental surgery. And it was a result of our early studies. And now more than 4,000 people in Czech Republic, they have such nano-implants made from nanostructural titanium in Russia. And presently, recently, it was also shown not only mechanical strength may be improved, bio properties may be improved through nanostructuring of titanium. And, for example, experiments, in vitro experiments showed the much higher occupation of fibroblast cells in this case, and observation of clinical testing of implants from nanostructural material showed much better healing period, recovery in this case. And physically, why? What is physical reason in this case? And to be found for nanotitanium, oxide layer, this is a very important parameter for biobehavior of medical materials. Oxide layer is different in chemical and crystallographical origin of oxide layer with nano-titanium is different and better for osteosynthesis, improvement of osteosynthesis. Okay, and now this topic is moving to many different kind of materials, not only pure titanium, but so-called beta titanium alloys, which have low elastic module, and this is even more attractive for medical application, and some cobalt-based materials, and so on. So nanostructuring is very promising a way how we can improve properties for materials for biomedical application. And few slides how we could develop some another multifunctional properties we call high strength and conductivity in the same time. And this is, of course, topic of conductors, or modern conductors. In many cases, it's important to have improvement of both these characteristic. However, pure metals, for example, what this is known conductors materials, silver, copper, gold, aluminium. Of course, copper and aluminium most attractive because they have low price and relatively high electric conductivity. But how we can enhance their mechanical properties, because this is important for many applications of conductors, advanced conductors. And our idea was we need to analyze strengthening mechanism and we need to control mechanism responsive for electric conductivity. And this again parameter solid solution hardening, precipitation hardening, dislocation, grain boundary strengthening. So through optimization of these parameters, this is example of nanostructural design, we can enhance these properties. And as a result of our analysis and then experimental work, we could produce ultra-fine grain, this is case aluminium alloys, similar for copper-based alloy, ultra-fine grain materials having small grain size particles, and due to this we have very high strength and conductivity, much better than initial materials. And such improvement you can see from this is green is existing conductors from aluminium materials, and this is from several European countries. What this existing conductor? This is new conductors produced with ultra-fine grain structure by improvement of both strength and conductivity, multifunctional behavior. And this is a result of nanostructural design and control of grain boundary structure. And why we consider this is important? For example, overhead power line. They have very strong requirements to have very strong strain and high conductivity. For example, distance between this опора is depends how strong rods, wires can be used like conductors. Okay, and from other hand, how we can improve our SPD technique to produce long-sized rods and then wires? As I mentioned, we have now equal chain and angular pressing. Such type technique should be installed in our laboratory in St. Petersburg State University very soon. And in this case, possible produce really many meters of nanostructural materials. This is example of copper-based materials with enhanced strength and conductivity. Radiation-resistant materials. Probably you know this is quite new topic. How we can enhance radiation-resistant? Through grain refinement. Now this is established, however, again question of what kind of grain boundaries we need. And the improvement in several times. It was first publication in this area, but now is established topic. For example, in MIFI, in Moscow, there is they have very special project how we can control radiation resistance through grain refinement. Also through grain boundary structure control, we can enhance thermostability. Very often, experts they consider, nanomaterials it should have low thermostability. However, through control of grain boundaries, we can essentially improve thermostability as well. Also, there is strong effect of grain boundary structure on corrosion behavior, and presently there are many examples of improvement of corrosion resistance, because in the beginning it was typically worse behavior. Okay, so really, bulk nanostructural materials, this is very promising for many interesting applications, and question is how we can move to this area. So innovation potential of bulk nanostructural is associated first of all with development of SPD techniques and improvement of properties. So from point of view innovation potential, we need to consider advanced materials, advanced properties, because it will be lead to new functionality, and due to advanced materials we can have new construction, new design of our product, and this is attractive. And presently there is strong movement in this direction, as I showed, making of different kind of this is pilot, of course, but products for like sheets, plates, profile, rods, wires for different kind of application, medical, including medical application, different kind of units, micro. Non-structural materials for micromechanics is very promising because making such small units from nanomaterials may improve not their functional properties like fatigue and toughness. And even possible to control presently physical properties, shape memory phenomena, very sensitive to grain boundary structure and grain size. Magnetic properties. And now there are some publication with improvement of conductivity and superconductivity through control of grain boundary structure. It's publication only from several months. And finally, I would like to demonstrate our book published last year with cooperation with Professor Terry Landon. He will be visit this university in June. Dr. Alex Zhelaev with accent of non-fundamentals and application of this material. Thank you very much for attention.
Речь шла о материалах наноструктуры и о некоторых видах изделий из них. У меня вопрос, кстати, там был у вас один из слайдов, нанометь стали. Очевидно, это в какой-то степени нанокомпозит, да? Можно рассматривать. Но просто вот эти все технологии, в какой степени можно прогнозировать их использование для получения объемных, протяженных с внутренними полостями изделий?
Ну, первое, это вообще вопрос масштабирования, а потом массовое производство. Ну, вот сейчас бы, это активно это дискутируется, потому что, ну, если вы видели металлургическое производство, это все-таки там большие здания, большие аппараты. Вот как из лаборатории вынести на эту шкалу? Вот, например, мы с Русалом дали такое предложение для проводников. Вот можно провода с очень высокой прочностью, электропроводностью. Но здесь оказалось нужно базовое оборудование создавать и покупать. Ну, например, такие есть английские машины исходные, которые потом оснащаются нашими оснастками. И ну, довольно дорогое удовольствие современное. Но нужен серьезный проект. И на этом пока идет обсуждение. Значит, но это все-таки относительно простые вещи по форме.
Это не фасонные изделия.
Да. Вот относительно фасонного, это обязательно в два этапа. Первое, вот получить такой материал, например, он может быть сверхпластичный, из него потом формовать более сложные. Да, уже дополнительная пластическая деформация. Потому что не CV, вот это мощная, интенсивная пластическая, а уже более известными нами.
Еще, простите, вопрос. Мы знаем и прогнозируем, как себя механизм вообще упрочнения, улучшения просто. А какой сейчас аппарат есть для того, чтобы прогнозировать поведение вот этих всех наноразмерных структурных элементов в процессе эксплуатации? Вот по имплантантам там идет на 24 часа. Проверяли там, что с ними случилось. А в принципе, что может произойти вот с этими наноструктурированными, в частности, нанокомпозитами?
Ну, вот это, понятно. Ну, вот этот знаменитый вопрос о термостабильности и там, вообще устойчивости. Это сильно зависит от вида материалов и вида применения. В медицине просто у них есть стандарты, которые никак не пройдешь, вот ты занимаешься. И там, например, особые усталостные свойства и так далее. Но, в принципе, к счастью, мы их достаточно легко проходим. Вот почему? Потому что, ну, в принципе, это комнатные температуры, там проблемы с нашим материалом возникают при температурах гораздо выше. Ну, например, на титановых сплавах градусов 400 и так далее. Вот нельзя нагревать до таких температур.
Простите, я имею в виду не результаты эксперимента, а прогнозирование.
Первое, так сказать, это естественный эксперимент и опыт. Это первое. И второе, это компьютерное моделирование сейчас очень активно развивается. Он еще, конечно, на стадии становления, но для примитивных наноматериалов. Но вот и в частности, это анализ. Это через молекулярную динамику, сегрегации на границе зерен, потом переход к свойствам. Это сейчас активные, даже специальные симпозиумы уже проводятся.
Спасибо. И последнее, извините, что я злоупотребляю ваше внимание. Есть у Гушаренко, вот, занимаются, так сказать, Белоруссии, там, в Израиле, Цукергип Пенетрейшн. Это тоже ведь метод наноструктурирования. Он как? Вы знакомы с ним? Естественно, да?
Вот такой подход я знаю.
Спасибо.
Вы упоминали о потере, так скажем, пластической устойчивости по критерию Харта в балок материалах. А существует ли подобный аналог вот потери пластичности за счет множественного образования трещин? Как таковой существует вот в нанокристаллических материалах, а сверхмелким зерном, меньше 100 нанометров и так далее. Спасибо.
Ну, интересно, в настоящее время в литературе обсуждается 10 примерно стратегий, путей, как мы можем повысить пластичность материала при очень высокой прочности. В этом парадокс, в этом проблема. Сохраняя очень высокую прочность, часто рекордную, в несколько раз выше известной для данного типа материала. Значит, и они, как правило, строятся на концепции там, введения дополнительных частиц, двойников, ну, вы знаете. Вот про введение трещин, которые потом позволят повысить, я не знаю, хотя... Может быть, есть тут и физическое основание. Мы предложили, я только рассмотрел одну стратегию, еще контролировать структуру границ зерен через зернограничную сегрегацию. И это оказывается очень эффективным путем, но в ряде случаев.
Еще есть? Тогда можно я? У меня есть вопрос в развитии вашего по поводу того, насколько рынок широк, насколько обширен и как быстро может выйти на индустриальные масштабы. Ведь сейчас существуют уже компании, которые уже занимаются созданием или производством наноструктурированных материалов.
Вот объемных и методами интенсивной пластической деформации, которые вот мы считаем наиболее перспективными для массового, к сожалению, еще нет.
Но существует вот это... же, кроме объемных, вы в самом начале показали методы,
ну, конечно, может быть, там плазма. Конечно. Наноматериалов их сейчас много, любой сотовый телефон, достаточно много наноматериалов. Я говорю вот о нашем классе материалов, мы их называем объемные наноструктурированные материалы, полученные интенсивной пластической деформацией. Здесь на пороге вот идет развитие методов, которые при масштабировании могут быть служить для массового производства. Но примитивно к имплантам они уже достаточно, потому что можно получать уже несколько тонн нанотитана, и это уже привлекательно для медицины. Но для стали, когда мы говорим о использовании стали, там, алюминиевых сплавов, нужно много тонн, тысячи тонн, и таких производств еще нет.
Но обычно потребителем сейчас все равно является аэрокосмическая в первую очередь. Вот Дента, ну это Biomedical Applications и аэрокосмические, потому что там прежде всего нужен вес. И поэтому в данном случае алюминиевые сплавы могут конкурировать с остальными, и несмотря на то, что они дороже, верно, и технологически не так удобны. Но, насколько я понимаю, аэрокосмические, ну просто по лабораториям, есть несколько лабораторий, как и ваши, я так понимаю, которые производят вот наноструктурированные материалы различными способами. Вы, допустим, вот северопластическим деформациям, равноугловое деформирование, они используют, например, свою там либо осаждение, электроосаждение, но в любом случае они получают прутки, которые дальше готовы купить там тот же Airbus, насколько я понимаю. Объемы их не так велики, но по сути они существуют. И вопрос был, существует ли уже кто в компании оформился и вышел с масштабов лаборатории до уровня компании?
Ну, я говорю, это полученные другими методами, возможно, потому что не часто в виде покрытий и так далее. Там мы знаем на инструмент, например, успешно на Роснано создавал такие предприятия. Относительно объемных, чтобы это были все-таки метры даже, вот это еще в стадии разработки.
То есть потребителя так, чтобы вот Аэробас покупал целиком пруток, нет, наверное, 100 килограмм.
Да, и чтобы это было, ну, как бы стабильно и все время в необходимом количестве и качестве, это на стадии разработки.
И еще тогда вопрос по поводу прогнозирования. Насколько я понимаю, ограничивается сильно вот в данном случае применение наноструктурированных объемных материалов тем, что температурная обработка фактически невозможна, в том числе...
Нет, это ограничение только для проблем жаропрочности, а для такого, ну, использования в районе комнатных температур.
Ну, и это технологические операции, которые позволяют изготавливать...
Сверхпластичность, она становится низкой температурой, то есть не тех в стандартных режимах, а ниже это работает, это уже проверено. То есть это широта довольно огромная, это большая, использование таких наноматериалов.
И вот мой вопрос следующий был по поводу сверхпластичности. Сверхпластичность сейчас уже вышла тоже из лабораторных исследований на этих материалах, она может быть применена при проведении технологических операций. Ну,
к сожалению, не в России, в Боинге уже начали.
Ну, по крайней мере, это технологически возможно использовать суперпластичность, да, именно при прессовании.
Да, при уменьшении размера зерна сверхпластичность заметно улучшается, ее становится возможным более эффективно использовать, они уже начинают.
А пример какой-то приведете, где они используют суперпластичность или сверхпластичность?
Там, правда, это еще не нано размер зерна, несколько больше, порядка 1 микрона. То есть это ультрамелкозернистый материал, но все-таки не наноматериал. Они используют в районе шасси вот этих частей, потому что очень прочные при комнатной температуре.
Они штампуют, да. Да.
И еще и формовка листов идет, я там точно не знаю, но вернее, мои коллеги из Верхней Салды, ну, демонстрировали некоторые примеры в Боинге.
Это алюминиевые сплавы?
Нет, да, титановые сплавы.
Титановые сплавы. Очень интересно, спасибо. Изда, пожалуйста.
Где-то в середине вашего выступления было интересно представлены истинные диаграммы растяжения для сплава алюминия и стали. И можно было обратить внимание, что 1 микрон – это тот размер, начиная с которого резко исчезает пластичность. Это случайно, вот вы и титан сейчас упомянули, то есть это какое-то физическое явление? И, наверное, менее вы добавляете модификаторы уже, да, интересные для поддержания этой пластических
слоев. Ну, это модификатор, это уже наше приближение, вот, которое мы развиваем. Мы их, конечно, не модификаторами называем, там, а специальная обработка, ведущая к появлению сегрегации на границе зерна. Но про 1 микрон вы совершенно верно. Где-то в районе 1 микрона для разных материалов.
Физика непонятна.
Понятно, почему изменяется механизм деформации. Ага. Он, Илья Анатольевич, он вам прям сразу уравнение прикинет. Это механизм деформации. Вот до этого, например, дислокации зарождались внутри зерна. При малом зерне они не могут зарождаться внутри. Они либо на границе, следовательно, эффект взаимодействия с границами, тогда появляются элементы проскальзывания, тогда механизм упрочнения. Нет, это довольно сейчас уже, может быть, не в полном виде модельные представители разы, но они достаточно.
Вы уже... извините, может быть, это тайна, но я знаю, что и в нано-области есть тоже критический параметр, меньше которого не рекомендуют спускаться. Нет такого у вас? Вот тут микроугласти.
Есть. Ну, это не... Есть. Я говорю, ну, вот, например, это тоже там порядка 30 нанометров, я показывал. Начинается не упрочнение, а разупрочнение. Тоже такие параметры, тоже в зависимости от разных материалов несколько отличаются. И там еще новый механизм деформации. Там начинается проскальзывание, и картина деформационного поведения снова меняется.
Спасибо.
То есть там много тайн и аномалий, как мы говорим.
Спасибо большое.
Спасибо.